by us in nothing. In other words, if you didn't repent of your moral license, if you did not repent of your sin, I'm going to turn you over to Satan. He did that in chapter 5. He turned a person over to Satan for the destruction of his flesh, that his soul would be preserved. You can read that. Paul had the power to turn people over to the devil. Obviously, the person he turned over to the devil got thrashed real good, because obviously that person repented, got right with God, and these people here he's addressing, they did not want to forgive that person. He says, look, if you don't forgive him, then Satan's going to get advantage over you because you are unrepentant over that person's repentance. That's what it's all dealing with here. So what we're saying here today, dear one, that you can repent over somebody's sins, hoping that they will repent over their personal sins. I cannot make someone's sins go away, but we can at least get the ball rolling when we say repenting over this nation, repenting over preachers, repenting over anybody. We can repent of their stupidity, their blindness, their pride, their hard-headedness. We can repent hoping that through that, the Spirit of God would deal with them, that they personally will repent of their sins. That has to be done by them. I cannot make their sins go away by me doing it, but that sets in motion God's Spirit dealing with people on repentance. And that's what Paul was dealing with. He says, obviously, the man that was turned over to Satan later on repented. And then he's saying here that if you don't forgive him when he repented of his sins and got himself right, if you hold a grudge against him, the devil's going to get advantage of you and ruin you.
Then Peter came up and said to him.
So it's important that if people do repent, that we don't hold grudges against them. That doesn't mean we have to like everybody and we have to be, you know, so buddy-buddy with people.
Lord, how often will my brother sin?
That they just forget what happened to him.
Sin against me and I forgive him.
Still, we can't hold grudges against someone and say, well, I don't believe they repented.
As many as 7 times?
Well, Paul is dealing with people that did repent here.
Jesus said to him,
that's the background. In case you don't know what that background was.
I do not say to you 7 times.
Okay, so sorrow, and then...
But 77 times.
He's also talking about godly sorrow. This is sorry, being sorry, a different Greek word, and godly sorrow. Now there's a sorrow. There is a sorrow. A godly sorrow that works repentance in us. If I had never felt sorrowful or regretted what I had did as a sinner, when I was a sinner, I did everything a sinner did. If I did not look back on those days and say, that's wrong, that's evil, I regret I ever did that, and made a U-turn and went to God and got godly sorrow, and that I regretted that I did that, then I'm not a true Christian. I'm just a fake, I'm a snake, you know, I'm a flake that churches are full of. They have no repentance, they don't feel sorry for their sins. In fact, people get up and testify how great of sinners they were. In fact, they are just so proud of it.
Hi there, I'm Nadia Boltzhover. I, strangely enough, am a Lutheran pastor.
You can get up and give sermons using the F word. They call it F-bombing now. I was just reading this morning. There's a certain woman in this country right now, she's making all the headlines. She uses the F word about every other word, and they think this is great. These are Christians. And I'm reading the raves that she's getting when she totally spices everything with the F word. That's her favorite word, the F word. She's a Lutheran pastor. She wears a sleeveless tank top with a clergy collar here, a little thing. She's got tattoos. Her whole, both arms are totally tattooed up. She's over 6 foot tall. Her hair is cut short like a dyke. She wears big dangling earrings, and she uses the F word. And another woman was commenting on her sermon, says, she does this F-bombing. I just wish I could be like her. She delivers the word of God with such passion and such, you know, her theology is so right on.
And I wrote a book called Pastrix, The Cranky, Beautiful Faith of a Sinner and Saint, which I guess is a messy, profanity and prayer-laden theological memoir. The first word in the book is shit, and then from there I just recall my deeply faithful yet deeply flawed life as it's been given to me to tell. And in a way, I think I wrote it for people like me, people who aren't culturally Christian, but who are hungry for a little bit of hope that doesn't come from vapid consumerism or the categories of late-stage capitalism or gazing at our own navels. I wrote it for people who listen to This American Life and who have maybe more education than money. I wrote it for people who know the difference between American cheese and actual cheese. I wrote it for people who totally see through the bullshit, and yet we secretly want some kind of transcendence or enchantment. I wrote it for women who talk to guys who like chick flicks. I wrote it for the gay man who loves Jesus but won't allow himself to be talked to like that. I wrote it for people like me. Maybe I wrote it for people like you. And my hope is that it'll end up mattering.
Adult, this is church. She's full of filth, and she is got a church called A Place for All Sinners, which she is obviously one. I can only feel sorry for this lady. I mean, I haven't seen her before. She's just up and coming. She's a new witch on the block out there, but she's really good at using the F word. And they think that's all part of the sermon now, that this is good, that people can relate to the F word. Do you know what the F word really is? Without saying it, do you know what that really represents? Whether heterosexual or homosexual? Why do you need to lace the words with the F word and try to get spiritual principles across? I use hell and damn quite often because they are biblical, and I try to use them in a biblical sense. And I use the word ass, sometimes real or imagined, because the Bible uses it. But I don't like the F word. Or some of the words are, I don't like other curse words that, you know, that may sound cute, but they have no meaning. But to say someone using that, call them F-bombing, and they say they're so passionate with the Word of God, and they're so deep into the Word of God, no, they're not even Christians. These are the kind of people that need to repent. These are the kind of people that God is angry with. This is what goes on in church now. And I thought McLaren was bad. Ball-headed freak McLaren marrying his own son to another man. I thought, no, he's lightweight now. You've produced this now. Now, this lady has got a congregation, and she'll produce the most filthy mouth, people running around screaming out everything you can imagine, and then they will produce something. Unless we repent, friends, and do business with God, God's going to do something to this country. I don't even have to threaten nobody about it. He's going to do something. I know Paul turned that person over to Satan. That's just for incest. And, of course, these other people are involved in every kind of kinky sin you can dream of. So, I don't have anything else to add to this today because I'm out of time, but we'll pick this up in the morning. Okay.
Some present at that very time who told him about the Galileans whose blood Pilate had mingled with their sacrifices, and he answered them, "Do you think that these Galileans were worse sinners than all the other Galileans because they suffered in this way? No, I tell you, but unless you repent, you will all likewise perish."
I speak unto thee this day, and I say, when I, the living God, do give the words of truth unto thee, that you can indeed repent, I say, do not run from the same. For I say that I, the living God, have never ever intended that my own people would put off the truth, would pretend that they do not hear the truth, would walk in disobedience to the truth. But I say that I've intended, if I, the living God, do send conviction upon thee, that you would indeed receive the same. That is, that you would choose to walk uprightly in that which I give to thee, which is my light upon the path. For I say, when you will accept conviction in your life and repent over sin, repent over those things that I, the living God, will show thee are possible, I say that you can be kept in me. But I say, if you are too proud to accept reproof and correction, I say you will never repent. Now I say you are living in a time when men are so full of pride on every hand, they do not even recognize what they do. That is, they do the things that are displeasing unto me, then they claim they are fine with me. Now I say this day that I, the living God, never called thee to walk in a way that is displeasing, but I say that I've called thee to come forth in my way. That is, I feel that you should indeed adjust your thinking to be pleasing to me. But I say, if you refuse to adjust your thinking and go on in your own headstrong ways, then I say you are destined to be damned. For I say, when a man or a woman refuses correction, refuses instruction, and most of all refuses to repent when evil is shown unto them, then I say they distress their own souls. Now I say this day that I, the living God, do not call thee to distress of soul, but I say that I call thee to the light. And I say that I call thee to be thankful that it is me that you can continue to look unto and believe. And I say that I call thee to be thankful that I will indeed be ever present to purpose, to lead, to guide thee forth. For I say it is me, the living God, who gives to my own the way wherein they are meant to walk. And I say likewise, when I, the living God, do give forth unto the sons of men the words of warning, it is that they would pay heed unto the same. That is, that they would indeed acknowledge their sin, their darkness, their evil intent, and not follow through with that. But they would indeed be repenting of the evil of their own hearts and not cover over the same. For I say, when any man or woman is true unto me, then they are guided in my way. But I say, when any man or woman will refuse to accept the conviction, will refuse to accept the warning, what do? I say, they set themselves up to be taken in folly. They set themselves up for deception. And yes, they are choosing such ways. Now I say this day that I, the living God, do offer unto my own the way wherein they will be kept if they keep their focus upon me. That is the way that is truth and light, strength and hope, and the peace provided for my own. And I say, if you will be accepting of the way that I, the living God, do offer to thee, then you are brought forth well pleasing unto me. But I say, if you are rejecting of the way that I give thee, you are rejecting of life. Now I say this day that you are living in a time when men have grown excessively disrespectful towards me. And I say it is because they have abandoned the fear of me, they have abandoned true repentance unto me, and I say they have chosen their own ways. And I say in the process of it all, they will find themselves taken into a way that will prove to be utterly destructive unto them. But I say it is because they have chosen their own way above the way that I provide. Now I say this day that I, the living God, do call thee to be thankful, to be uplifted, to be directed, to be ever guided by me. And I say that I do indeed call thee to be ever purposed in the blessedness, the truth, and the light that I provide. For I say, when you really consider that I, the living God, do have abundance of mercy and truth, life and strength and hope intended for thee, I say, walk in the way. That is, do not go in the way of the hard-headed, stubborn, and proud fool who end in a heap of damnation. But I say, each day be thankful that I, the living God, am ever present to correct thee, direct thee, and guide thee forth. And I say, be thankful each day that I, the living God, am ever present to show unto thee the way of my life. For I say, through me you are given the blessedness, through me you are given the truth, and through me you are given the mercy. And I say, when you will indeed be humbling yourself unto me, then I say you are directed by me. Now I say this day that I, the living God, do find much joy and pleasure in a people who will humble themselves, a people who will bow down low and be ever guided by me. But I say that I do indeed have sore displeasure with the ones who are intent on their own way. For I say, in the times that ye are in, men are so headstrong to have their own way, so stubborn and proud, what do they bring forth? I say, they bring forth nothing but destruction and devastation of soul. Now I say this day that I, the living God, do not call thee to the way of destruction and devastation, but I say that I call thee to the way of my life. And yes, indeed, I call thee to be ever strengthened, uplifted, and shown that through me you are given abundance of mercy. For I say, if you walk in the humility way that I put before thee, so are you uplifted in me. But I say, if you go in the way of proud fools, so do you bring to yourself the course of damnation. Now I say this day that I, the living God, do not intend that the ones who claim they are mine would walk afar off from me. But I say that I have intended that the ones who are mine would be ever present in the truth, the light, the strength that I give day by day. For I say it is indeed a privilege to be ever strengthened, to be uplifted and directed by me.